Hello, people of the world. You are listening to this episode during the second week of Max Fun Drive. If you're listening to it when it releases, that is where you get all sorts of cool gifts for becoming a new, upgrading, or boosting member over at MaximumFun.org/join. We're going to tell you about that later in the show, but we want to tell you right now, very quickly, about our show-specific goal, which is 450 new/boosting/upgrading members. Mark, what's going to happen when we hit that goal?
Well, Hal, what happens when we reach that goal is we will revisit one of our most contentious decisions we've ever made on the show. For those of you who have listened in the past, Hal and I have reached intractable point one other time in the history of this show. And we were so dug in our own decisions and thoughts on a subject that we had to get outside help. We got it from John Hodgman, the judge, his honor on Judge John Hodgman. It did not go my way. In fact, it could not have gone worse for me when we did that episode of Judge John Hodgman. So if we reach 450 new upgrading or boosting members, then we will go back on the Judge John Hodgman show and I will get a chance to redeem my terrible performance the last time around. And we will, with the help of Judge John Hodgman, hopefully overturn Hal's obstinance in our decision about what the best pretzel shape was.
And that is only going to happen if we hit 450 total new/upgrading/boosting members. So to make that happen and to learn about all the other great gifts and things that are going on during Max Fun Drive and how you can support this show and the Max Fun Network, go to MaximumFun.org/join. I'll always say it.
I love it. And now, please enjoy We Got This with Mark and Hal.
Hello, I'm Hal Lublin.
And I'm Mark Gagliardi.
Since the dawn of humanity, one issue has gone unsettled. With the fate of the world in the balance, we're here to settle once and for all.
Best immortal film.
That's right. Don't worry, everyone. We got this.
Podcasts should have a theme song.
Podcasts should not have a theme song.
Yes, they should.
No, they shouldn't.
They sound good.
Yeah, but people are just going to skip past it.
You know what?
You're right. We got this.
This is Halloween. This is Halloween.
No, no.
What?
No, this is not one of them. Don't.
That's
why would
true.
You even start?
I'll tell you why.
Set an expectation amongst our listeners. Hello to all of you.
Hi, everybody. Hello, people of the world. Because when I hear, we got this,
it sounds like it was recorded by the same recording artists that went in the studio and dropped that track. This is Halloween.
They dropped that track.
Yeah, they dropped that track. Did I say that right?
Yeah, sure.
Awesome.
Yeah. Of course.
We are here to talk about Tim Burton movies, Hal, but we are not alone.
That's right. We have good friends of ours who we've known for 16 years, 15, 16 years. Crazy to think.
Yes.
Two prominent voices you've heard everywhere. You've heard of all over the place. You've seen them on screen. They've literally written the book on voice acting, by the way.
Yeah.
They are Yuri Lowenthal and Tara Platt. Hello.
Hi, guys.
Hi,
for
y'all.
Having us on the show.
Hi. I really do think of you two as the first couple of voice acting.
Correct.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm giving you a royal wave.
Hello.
Yes. You're the corgis. You're the queen's corgis.
Yes. Yes.
Of voice acting.
That is much more appropriate.
Hello.
And you selected this topic. Why?
Well, you know, in retrospect, it was probably a bad idea. let's just say we selected from we gave you a few that we thought were good, and this was good. It seemed good at the time. Mm-hmm.
Are you questioning
we were actually,
your life choices?
We were, well, I was hoping for another one, and I just sort of had in
you
my,
assumed
in my head,
that that's what they were going to select.
I would get the one that I really wanted.
Oh. Well, you'll come back, and we'll do that one another
time.
Yeah. Okay. This is not the only time the two of you will be on the show.
Okay. Well, we'll talk about which one that is later because we certainly don't want to spoil anything for people.
Of course.
But yeah, this was a very deep hole. Once it was set and I started thinking about it and we started talking about it, this is not going to be easy.
No, there are some great movies in there and there are some really polarizing movies in there.
100%.
Did you find one or more of them to be particularly polarizing for the two of you?
Well, I mean, like, there were certain ones that I remembered because the truth is I'm one of those people that really only watches movies once. I don't tend to go back and rewatch movies. Well, he will rewatch movies, which is probably why he's a better writer than I am, because he rewatches them and figures out why they work and why they don't work. Whereas I just sort of like it or don't like it. And then I'm done.
I'm with you, though, Tara. I just watch them and enjoy them.
Yeah.
And I watch them multiple times and study them like they're the Zapruder film.
So there you go.
We're the same couple.
So there are movies like Big Fish that I remember being bedazzled by when I was watching it, but I didn't walk away with sort of, I don't know.
Right. Whereas I just remember really disliking Big Fish. Like Big Fish did not work for me. It felt like it should. I'm like, oh, that's where that emotional abuse should be. And that should be a thing that's going to make me start crying now. And it just, it did not feel organic ever to me.
But I also struggle because I'm very much all about aesthetics. So you give me a director that's good at aesthetics, a Jean-Pierre Jeunet, a Tim Burton, someone like that. And I will just eat up their work because it's all about like pretty eye candy that I'm getting. And I care less when I'm getting all that pretty eye candy about if the beats pay off and if things like that. Like I'm much more forgiving of this wildly aesthetic world that they've created than I would be if it's just this like drama and I'm watching what's happening and I'm like, I don't believe that. So I'm already going to be very forgiving of something that's coming out of a person like a Tim Burton because I'm like, oh, this is what I want. I want a Wes Anderson. I want a Tim Burton. I want something that's wildly, vividly aesthetic. So like for Big Fish, I was like, I just liked all the pretty. Like I didn't, it was less to me about the payoffs or the no payoffs with things like that because I wasn't focusing on whether I was getting that. I was so excited about things floating in the air. Like that's all that I have, you know, like that's, I don't know.
Yeah.
I think that's what makes a Tim Burton movie a Tim Burton movie, though, is that aesthetic that he comes from animation. He comes from drawing a very specific, like goth kid in Burbank style.
Yeah.
And that permeates everything that he does. So I think in like coming up with our criteria for these movies and how we are going to judge them in order to objectively determine which of these is the best, I think aesthetics has got to be at the top, if not near the top, if not at the top of the list of things we got to talk about.
Yeah, yeah. He always seems to put that before story and character anyway. So we might as well.
Yeah, Tim Burton is like, there are like maybe four like mother sauces to Tim Burton. One of them is like that Edward Gorey meets Dr. Seuss visual style.
Yeah.
The other is his desire to delve into the stories that he loved as a child and reimagine and retell them. Then there's the season that he sort of seems to be in now that started earlier. Like they're all sort of interwoven of, I want to tell an actual story and you're going to feel my fingerprints all over this, but it's not going to be, you know, Ed Wood and Edward Scissorhands, which are made 4 years apart, are very different movies. Mm-hmm. Were they you can only tell made they're made by the same guy.
Were they only made 4 years apart?
I mean,
that's wild.
Here's the interesting thing. He makes Frankenweenie, which gets him fired from Disney, but gets Paul Reubens' attention. So he handpicks Tim Burton to direct Pee-wee's Big Adventure. That movie explodes and he takes 3 years to pick his next project because he doesn't like anything thrown at him. The next thing that he makes is Beetlejuice.
Yes.
Which
One's my favorite.
I'm glad you brought up Beetlejuice and Ed Wood because I think those are going to be rising to the top for us.
Yeah.
Those are already on the Mount Rushmore.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I will say it would be hard to overlook Batman just because of where I was as, you know, a teenager in high school who, you know, loved Batman all his life, but who, you know, had just come off of reading, you know, The Dark Knight Returns, which is, you know, one of the greatest Batman stories ever told, but a reinventing. And so we were all so excited and, you know, me and all my friends to go to this movie right after this sort of, you know, very dark Batman tale had been told.
Wait, this is the Michael Keaton.
This is Michael Keaton and Jack Nicholson. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, you know, so it was important for me in the moment. And yet it currently doesn't, you know, isn't in my top.
Is it because he doesn't go, I'm Batman?
Is it the Christian Bale Batman?
That way?
Michael Keaton had his own version of Christian Bale's Batman.
Yeah, Michael Keaton was more whispering.
Yeah.
He's like,
if I don't phonate, they won't know who I am.
Yeah.
That's how I answer the phone if it's telemarketers, so they don't know who I am. I'm like, just don't phonate and they won't know.
Hello.
Yeah. I mean, it's so like, it's weird to think the guy who made Big Eyes is the same guy who bought the rights to a trading card set and made Mars Attacks.
Yes.
Which he changed. Yeah. He couldn't decide between Dinosaurs Attack and Mars Attacks. But when Jurassic Park came out, he's like, I'll go with Mars Attacks, then releases it the same summer as Independence Day. So
Right.
Yeah. It wasn't going to, the movie's not, I mean, again, that's like aesthetically, this is, I love that movie's aesthetics.
Right. Sure.
Mm-hmm. 100%.
But as a movie, I only remember Slim Whitman making their heads explode.
Yeah. Yeah, I visually, I only remember the images from the movie. I don't remember anything about the story. Like, if you asked me what the story was, I'd be like, Mars, it attacked.
Yeah. Martians showed up and they were dicks.
I don't know.
Premise of that movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Was Mars Attacks, does anybody know the history of this movie in that, like, was there studio influence on him in this? Was this just him unfettered doing whatever he wanted? Because the latter is kind of what that movie feels like, is that this guy has been a huge, huge force in Hollywood for just a handful of years at this point. Mm-hmm. And they're like, make whatever you want. It's almost like when they gave Julie Taymor free rein to make a Spider-Man musical.
Right.
And
right.
And then they went, oh, without boundaries, you really need to be, your genius really needs to be reined in.
Yeah.
So let's tighten the constraints on this a little bit. Does it feel too like youthful, unconstrained Burton? That's what it feels like to me.
It's just, it's based on trading cards.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Like what?
Right.
There's not, if you want him with unfettered, so Batman's a huge hit and he can make whatever he wants. So he makes Edward Scissorhands. That's him with free reign. Then he agrees to come back for Batman Returns, but says, I want complete creative control. Mm-hmm. And then that is him both small budget and big budget doing whatever he wants. Those two movies are probably the best example of him doing, like, having complete creative control over something.
Yeah.
How do you
yeah.
feel about those two? I'm famously not a Batman Returns fan. I didn't like what happened with the Penguin because I like that character from the comics, but now the comics reflect what he did. So, I mean, I know I feel like I'm in the minority here, but how do the two of you feel about that?
I mean, I really liked it at the time. I liked the darkness he brought to it. I like how disgusting the Penguin was in that movie.
Yeah.
I like him, introducing other villains. You know, that's what we needed from a second Batman film. And the aesthetic still worked, but it was almost like it was used up at the end of that film and it needed to go in a completely different direction, which, it sort of did. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were trying to, beyond that film, they were trying to maintain some of the things without him, some of the stylistic elements, but it had to go in a different direction.
I think my brain has sort of squished those two films together, though, Batman and that. Like,
For sure.
I don't know that I could distinguish scenes that I can visually remember if it was Batman or Batman Returns. Like, it's just, it's a little, like, smushed together for me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
They're very similar. Like, they have the same visual language.
Yeah. Which is not necessarily bad. Like, many directors have a visual language.
We love his visual language.
Sure.
I believe that in a way that was, Edward Scissorhands has so much of his heart, but I believe the pinnacle of that was Beetlejuice for me. Beetlejuice had, for me, everything. It had the right cast. It had the right look. It had the right weirdness employed in a story that you could use that without it feeling like, oh, it's just the trappings of weirdness on top of something that doesn't really make any sense. Like, it felt organic to that story.
But for me, like with Beetlejuice, it almost feels like every single other title that we've listed of his is in Beetlejuice. Like, if you look at Beetlejuice, it feels like it's his sort of ultimate film because it has all of the other strains that he went on to play with in every other, like, it has some Mars Attacks in it and it has some Batman in it and it has some Big Fish in it and it has some Ed Wood. Like, it has all of the strings and it's almost as if that's his symphony because he was able to, like, looking at a little bit of everything he wanted to do and sort of play it there as opposed to other things where he was kind of focusing on one and it may or may not work. I felt like with Beetlejuice, it worked to great effect because he was able to pull all those elements in that he wanted to play with and wanted to try out and was excited about and dark and weird and interesting and heartfelt and good story and interesting characters. Like, it felt like it had all the elements and yet was still elevated and heightened and didn't feel like it was sort of taking a step back for any reason, whether it was studio or, like, it just felt like it really embodied him.
And he was still scrappy too.
Yeah, but it had a scrappy feel to it. If you had to ask for what's a film that represents that particular director, it feels like Beetlejuice to me because it has all of the elements. Like, I feel like he has.
Like you were saying, not only aesthetically does it have all of the elements, the wacky characters, the macabre, the cool color palette, the like all of those things, but story-wise, yeah. It has things that he dove into a lot too. Relationships between parents and their kids, mm-hmm. The one weirdo kid that feels like an outsider in a suburban yeah. world, like yeah. all of those
death
elements.
And that, what that looks like, yeah. like mm-hmm. the afterlife. I mean, yeah. like that's his... You know,
yeah.
Do you think that those were things that were all in him that all came out at that point? Or do you think that they came out to serve that story and then became things that were his signatures?
I believe that they were mm-hmm. him. And because he was still trying to figure out what his signature was. And
I came up with an interesting, because we're talking about Beetlejuice, and I would also like to bring Ed Wood into this. When yeah. I was trying to determine, because Ed Wood and Beetlejuice are probably my two favorite films, and I was trying to, you know, find which one of those was the winner.
Beetlejuice.
And the answer is
Beetlejuice.
And I came to
don't say it one more time.
Right? If you say it, Michael Keaton will show up again.
Really? Should I say it again? Will we get green, weird foamy glass?
Not Beetlejuice, but Michael Keaton actually.
Yeah, Michael Keaton himself. Yeah. Actually, Birdman will show up following that leap. He will just land in your yard. We don't know where he
is. I said it one time and I got clean and sober, Michael Keaton. It was a real bummer.
As long as you didn't get Jack Frost, Michael Keaton.
Nope.
Or all of the multiplicity Michael Keatons.
Or all the But I had to split it into two very sort of similar but different categories. And one was the best Tim Burton directed film. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. one was the best film directed by Tim Burton.
Oh, like you're deep though. Like yeah. Beetlejuice, you watch movies more than
Beetlejuice
once.
Yeah. is a quintessential Tim Burton film style film for me.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And one of the greatest. But Ed Wood, I believe, is a better directed film by Tim Burton, but has less of you know, the colorful trappings. It still has a lot of his style, but yeah. I believe it is a better directed film and ultimately a better story.
Your argument and I accept it. That was a really good logic.
Yeah, laid
out.
It is. It's a more restrained mm-hmm. direction. Yeah. I mean, obviously Ed Wood is someone he has an affinity for sure. And that style of film, you know, he's a huge Vincent Price fan, has an uncompleted Vincent Price documentary that who knows yeah. if it'll ever see the light of day. So I'll be honest, in the Tim Burton film canon, that was the movie I had not seen and I watched it this past week in preparation. I was like, I can't talk about Tim Burton without having seen this.
Yeah. And I made a poor choice last night at about midnight. I was like, if I'm going to talk about this tomorrow, I have to make sure I have to remember. So, so at midnight last night, I put in Ed Wood and started watching it. And,
you've seen it already,
but it had been a while. again, to your point,
Hal gets it.
But Hal gets me.
Yeah,
yeah. You got to return.
You see me, Hal. I feel seen, Hal.
Yeah. But, well, your memory of a film, if you saw it a long time ago, it's either going to be idealized or
right. It's like you have to trust your instinct. So if you watch a movie and you like it or you don't like it, you have to trust that was your instinct. And watching it another 50 times isn't going to necessarily make your initial instinct wrong just because now you're familiar with it.
Well, but I only needed 30 minutes I didn't have to watch the whole thing again be able to come in and legitimately sort of make that point. Plus, I had just watched back-to-back two Godzilla movies and it was midnight and there's no way, I'm old and there's no way I was going to watch the whole thing.
Sure.
But it is a, you know, an utter delight. And correct me if I'm wrong, how many Academy Awards has he won? Just two for that film, right?
They've all been nominated. There are a couple of art direction Academy Awards out there that have been won by him. But that was only acting.
Yeah. Yeah, it was Martin Landau and the makeup. It's interesting how almost in the beginning, he was trying to decide if Michael Keaton was going to be his muse or Johnny Depp was going to be his muse, and Johnny Depp won. Rightfully so, because I think Johnny Depp is sort of how Tim Burton sees himself, you know, in the world. And, you know, as Johnny Depp established, you know, him with Edward Scissorhands and all that. Mm-hmm. But he's so good in Wood and... It's such a delight to watch.
He is. The whole cast is great.
Yeah.
It's a cast. Coming off of it, I think it's such a great homage to those films, and it has the feeling of those movies as well, where there's sort of a disjointed nature to it. But I think partially by intention and partially because maybe the story of Ed Wood isn't as interesting as he, like, I don't find it as interesting as he found it. but I enjoyed watching it play out. Mm-hmm. And the performances are all great. And it feels like it just kind of ends. But also, all those movies just kind of end.
Yeah. And it is stripped down. You're right. It didn't need a crazy story. Mm-hmm. It just needed that, you know, human story. And he didn't need to paint it up with, you know, garish colors and, you know, weird puppets and stop motion and things like that to make that work. And I'm a sucker for old Hollywood, so it had me there. Now, if it had been the Ben Chapman story, you know, that would have been really interesting.
I would have loved it. I would have loved to watch the Ben Chapman story, the fictional version or the nonfiction version.
Yeah, a little Hollywood.
With Johnny Depp playing
Hang on a second. There is something about this that he does really well in his movies, which I think is the when and the where. You know, if you've got the five W's, and when and where are a huge part of what he does. And he so often creates a when and where that is the when is timeless and the where is Tim Burton land.
Right.
Yeah. So to see him shoot something that where the when and the where are, no, it is the San Fernando Valley in the 1950s.
Yeah.
Regardless of whether or not it is timeless Tim Burton land or if it's a specific place in time, it is always so specifically laid out. And I think that this movie, I think Ed Wood in particular is his best. Well, there's a reason this won our episode. This was the ultimate winner in our episode of best Los Angeles movie.
Yeah.
Because it does get that place and time so perfectly right. Mm-hmm. But I think going back to what Tara was saying earlier about aesthetics, I don't know that that is an incredible movie. And as a movie, it's better. I think that what you were saying before about, do you want the best movie that's directed by Tim Burton or do you want the best Tim Burton movie? I think those aesthetics are required of a Tim Burton movie. I need something striped to unfurl at some point.
Yes.
Yeah. You know,
I'll tell you what. I think we all agree Beetlejuice is a finalist. I think Ed Wood is a finalist as well. I want to take a break because we're in the middle of Max Fun Drive.
You want some Edward Scissorhands.
Yeah, we're going to
Because there are a lot of people screaming about us not talking about Edward Scissorhands.
When we come back from this brief break to talk to you about Max Fun Drive, we're going to get into Edward Scissorhands. And I want to dig specifically into his Disney oeuvre and see if there are perhaps any finalists there. We'll be right back.
That's how you pronounce that word?
You know, everybody pronounces it a little different.
Who knows?
Everybody's right.
Oh, we are.
Isn't that French for egg?
Yes. I think so.
That's right.
Hey, did you know it's Max Fun Drive?
I did. It's week two.
What?
Yes.
Week two of Max Fun Drive.
What?
How? Tell this listener what Max Fun Drive is.
Yes. If you didn't already know, Max Fun Drive is the time of year when we all come together to support the shows on Max Fun. Shows like, oh, I don't know. This one, when you become a member during Max Fun Drive, you get to decide which shows benefit. Max Fun is audience supported, which means that we're free to make the content you enjoy because people like you contribute.
That's right. We have been super lucky to have such a great community grow around us. We've been with Max Fun for a while now, and we've watched this community grow and bring in new people. And we've gotten to know a lot of people involved both with the shows and fans of the shows and members of the Max Fun Network. Basically, as a member, you become part of creating the show. The artists make the content, the audience listens and shares, and the members provide the funding that makes it all possible.
Yes. This year in particular has shown us how valuable our favorite creators are. I know that I've been taking more time to support creators whose work that I enjoy because they've kept us company. They've given us familiar voices to make us laugh, think, interact, and just feel normal for a second. That's what we want our show to be, is your escape from everything going on in the world to just laugh and argue about dumb stuff for just 45 minutes or so. And if we've done that for you, and you're able to join, now is the time to do it.
So here's how this works. Membership at Max Fun starts at $5 a month. That gets you all the bonus content. You'll be able to access that as long as you are a member. And there is a whole lot of it already waiting for you right now. We have years of it.
Yes.
We've got some amazing bonus content.
At $10 a month, if you're able to join or upgrade, you're going to get a Max Fun membership card and a really cool pin of your choice. Each show's got one.
Yeah, ours is fantastic. Ours is the best. It's of so all bad. Of our pins, this is the best band. And this is the last year for a while that we're going to be doing pins. So, you know, complete your early Max Fun era pin collection.
Yes.
With our favorite pin this year, which is a picture of the best pretzel shape, which is pretzel shape. And then Hal's incorrect opinion about it, encircling it, which is this is not the best pretzel shape. It has been the most divisive decision of our show in a very long time. And it has been an absolute delight to read all of the comments about. So get that pin.
And then listen to the episodes. I can be vindicated.
Oh, I don't think it's vindication. Mark, nobody that's listened to the episode thinks that you are vindicated in
Mark,
this.
You're talking that garbage. This is our sixth year of Max Fun, so we're this many.
He just held up six fingers on one hand.
I did. Well, I killed Inigo Montoya's father. At $20 or more, you get this year's very special gift, which is the Max Fun Take a Minute Tea Kit. Tell them about it, Mark.
The Max Fun Take a Minute Tea Kit. Look, it's been a tough year for everybody. Don't you sometimes just want to sit down, turn on your favorite podcast? We got this with Mark and Hal, and pour yourself a delicious cup of tea. Why not do it with the Max Fun Take a Minute Tea Kit, a custom tin with art by Atomic Pixies, a rocket shaped tea infuser, and a custom Max Fun blend of tea from our friends at Wishes Tea. You deserve to take a minute for yourself and enjoy a nice cup of tea.
If you are already a member, thank you so much for supporting the show and making it happen. And if you haven't yet become a member and you're able to do so, you're not only supporting the show, but you're supporting all of the listeners of the show who are not able to become members at this time. And that is a huge deal.
Amen. So if you want a JBU, that's join, boost, or upgrade, go to MaximumFun.org/join. But right now, let's get back to this episode of We Got This with Mark and Hal.
No discussion of Tim Burton's work would be complete without discussing his most personal film, an allegory about his childhood in Burbank, California, which is 1990s Edward Scissorhands. It's also the first time he ever worked with Johnny Depp, and they have collaborated on, I think, if my numbers are right, 3 million movies since then.
Yeah.
It's correct. Let me check IMDb. Can't confirm.
Is it 3.2 million?
It's up to 3.2.
Right. Since we started. 200,000. Yeah.
Right. Since we started this podcast.
It's like tracking Dogecoin. It just keeps going up. It keeps going up. They're not. Oh, nope. There they go. They're working together. They're going to remake the Falcon Snowman. Anyway.
Depcoin.
Yeah. Depcoin. He's putting it all in Depcoin. I like this movie. I don't love it. And I don't know.
Oh,
visually,
I love this movie.
I think it's real interesting. I love the haircuts. I love that. Mm-hmm. Weird, like, this is how I saw Burbank in the 1960s when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm. But that becomes such a seamless point of view from Tim Burton as a kid in Burbank in the 60s to the character Edward Scissorhands, the way he sees this. We're like, this is such a great example of, I mean, I can tell you who the protagonist is in Beetlejuice. Mm-hmm. I can't necessarily tell you whose eyes we're watching the movie through. Probably Lydia's.
Right, right. Catherine O'Hara, always.
Catherine O'Hara, yeah.
All things should be viewed through Catherine O'Hara's eyes.
Sure.
The entire world should just be viewed through Catherine O'Hara's eyes. But this movie is so, you are watching, this is the way that Edward Scissorhands sees the world. So the ice sculpture turning into snow, the sort of grotesque neighborhood with the perfect Burbank pastels, like that to me is so beautiful about it. And I think that seeing the world through an innocent outsider's eyes created such a lovely fairy tale with that movie, I think.
Mm-hmm. Agreed. I would not disagree on any of those points. The one thing that I feel you've neglected to bring in is also the reinvention and reintroduction into Hollywood of Anthony Michael Hall, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
The villain. That's
it was
true.
Like swole, Anthony Michael Swole. Yeah.
He left SNL and went straight to a gym. That was it.
Right, exactly. Right. His transformation from 16 Candles to Anthony Michael Hall to jock heartthrob Anthony Michael Hall.
It's pretty great. Did any of you guys go to that exhibit a few years ago in Los Angeles? The Tim Burton exhibit?
At the LACMA. LACMA, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
That to me, seeing all of those, for those who don't know, there was a huge retrospective of Tim Burton's work going back to drawings he drew as a kid and then things he did. I think he was on, was it like local TV or local radio?
Yeah, something like that.
Mm-hmm. They had
or like, oh no, he was working for like a local ad company because he was doing like lawn ads for landscapers and stuff. But just seeing all of this stuff and seeing the world through those eyes, you really get a sense of his viewpoint on the world. So I would argue that if it is about the most Tim Burton movie and you want to see a movie through Tim Burton's eyes, Edward Scissorhands is seeing the world through Tim Burton's eyes.
Mm.
Nothing striped and tentacly unfurls at us in this movie, I don't think.
I hear what you're saying, and I agree that it's through his eyes.
It is, but almost so the purest view.
Right, but when you look at someone who you're talking about as a creative or as an artist, so a director or a performer, or like you're trying to figure out what makes them them. So like, why is it their film, you know, why is Pan's Labyrinth Guillermo del Toro's? You know what I mean? Like, why is it his film?
Another
why
good retrospective at LACMA, by the way.
That's true. Why is it a Tim Burton film? I think that rather than just getting the perspective of getting to see through his eyes, you need to also have his aesthetic, which is where he's taken himself from being able to look through his eyes and then going into the world that he actually wants to create. So I hear what you're saying, but I feel like Beetlejuice takes it that step farther because it does let us get what Tim Burton's trying to put into the world as a creative and as an artist. He now has his special Tim Burton sauce to put on it. And that's what gives you Beetlejuice over Edward Scissorhands.
Right. Yeah. In a way, Edward Scissorhands was his reality and his fantasy. You know, Tim Burton, looking at sort of him and all he does and his aesthetic and everything, he does wish he were dead as a ghost and could, you know, I mean, and so that is his fantasy realized. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. There is something like, I love the commentary for him to say, I stood out and was a freak when I was younger, felt like a freak because I felt unfinished.
Yeah.
That's really why he has the Scissorhands. His Vincent Price died before he could finish him. So if that's a feeling that's inside him, there's a lot to unpack there. And that makes it a film worth watching multiple times. I don't think it stands up to either of the two that are in the finals. I feel like if we put it in the finals, it would just be for the sake of placating.
I think there would be a lot placating the listeners because I think there would be a lot of listeners who would fight you on that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, they should get a podcast.
One of them
it.
Is gags, I think.
Look, I do understand. No, because I will profess my love for the movie Edward Scissorhands, but I do not personally think, I think we've already talked about the winner of this. And I think that we all might already be in agreement, but we still have more movies to talk about. You wanted to talk about Disney.
I just want to talk about his Disney movies, that being Dumbo and Alice in Wonderland.
Mm-hmm.
You know, obviously that's where he starts. He's 22, he's right out of CalArts, starts working at Disney, works on Fox and the Hound, Tron, Sword in the Stone, does all that stuff. So he comes back to Disney to direct Alice in Wonderland and Dumbo, which I cannot watch. I cannot watch, especially since I couldn't watch it as a kid when my mother was alive. I certainly can't watch it now ever again.
Yeah, we haven't seen it either.
Yeah. Is there anything to him? The only film that I've seen him where I've seen him cover somebody else's or an existing thing and bring it that I enjoyed was Sleepy Hollow.
But that was his own, you know, reinvention of a tale that, you know, is sort of been handed down. So that does feel much. It feels like he's got much more ownership on Sleepy Hollow.
But even like with Alice in Wonderland, it very much felt like he was doing it for someone else and trying to put his special sauce on it. Like it didn't in any way feel to me like I was watching a Tim Burton film, except that, they did some interesting aesthetics and the costumer got to go have fun. Like it just didn't quite.
Some stripey something unrolled at some point during that film. I'm sure of it.
But it just didn't. It felt like somebody got hired because they liked the other things. And then they wanted them to do it on their project, but they already had the story and the plot and the characters and you couldn't change that. And so now it was sort of a little bit of, well, we'll throw it all in the pot and sort of see what comes out.
Yeah.
They were saying, hey, put a Tim Burton layer on Alice in Wonderland.
Yeah.
Right.
And then afterwards they were like,
it's a skin. Yeah.
It's
a skin.
But Alice in Wonderland is already wacky. You don't like it. You don't. it can stand on its own. It doesn't need that to make it.
Yeah.
Right.
No, it needs Johnny Depp dancing. That's what it needs.
This needs more grayscale. Can we get Tim Burton in here to put a hat on a hat on another hat?
I'll tell you what I did not like about that movie. I remember seeing that movie in the theater, and this was the first time I had seen a movie where they digitally, after the fact, made something 3D.
Yeah.
And it did not look like a 3D movie. It looked like I was watching a Viewmaster through sunglasses, which makes it a difficult way. Like, all of the backgrounds are in 3D, but they just did this sort of layered thing where they're like, okay, put this two-dimensional film piece that we shot in this layer. So it looked like it was shot with a flat plane camera.
Yeah.
As opposed to actually shot in 3D. That is not Tim Burton's fault. I don't think that he had an intention of this being a 3D movie. I think they added that element to it. But it does feel like they just said, add a Tim Burton skin to Alice in Wonderland. With Dumbo, it's like they said, hey, all that stuff we love about Tim Burton, don't do any of that stuff.
Right.
Just like do the bare minimum, like slightly tattered circus tent aesthetic of Tim Burton-iness, but that's all we want is just that tiny little touch of it.
Bit of personal trivia from Alice in Wonderland.
Please.
They had to, at some point, you know, as you always do, ADR and, you know, background stuff and so on for the things that didn't come out right on set, and they have to do it, but you can't get the actors, so you're looking for somebody to replace. I screamed for Crispin Glover in that movie, and every now and then I get like a 15-cent residual check.
Pretty awesome.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Because I'm always like, you worked on Alice in Wonderland? Oh, yeah, you did. Like, when the check comes in the mail, just when it's
I can only imagine from what I've heard about Crispin Glover, who I, you know, had my own sort of Hollywood moment with him once in a restaurant, which was not really much of a Hollywood moment. It was, you know, I caught his eye and he sort of stared at me. And then we had sort of this bit of a staring contest, and which I couldn't take my eyes off him because he was Crispin Glover.
Yeah.
How did Crispin Glover not wind up the muse? Like, it was like, well, let's try out Michael Keaton for a little while, then Johnny Depp for like a good decade. Then Crispin Glover shows up like, where have you been all my life, Crispin Glover?
Yeah.
It's peanut butter and chocolate, Tim Burton and Crispin Glover.
Did he come over to you? What happened? What was the...
Nothing ever happened. As I remember it, he finally broke the gaze, which I felt somehow proud. Like, I always thought he would just drill into my soul and would like follow me home and just keep staring until something, you know, happened. I can only imagine that if they needed to get Crispin Glover to come in and, you know, do a little scream for Alice in Wonderland after he had made the movie, it was probably easier to book someone else.
Listen, if I don't ask this now, I'll never get a chance to do this again. After he broke, before he broke his gaze, did you go, blink, McFly, blink? I can't help it. I had to do it. Sorry. That's not
me. You will always be Hal Loveland. You can't help but be Hal Loveland.
Oh, I can't let that one get past. Come on.
No, that was good. That's good.
While we're talking about his Disney stuff,
yes,
that leads me mentally to other properties from childhood that Tim Burton may have been in contact with or known about.
Love's Roald Dahl.
That he did his take on. I'm thinking of Sweeney Todd. I'm thinking of...
Wait, you say from childhood?
Well, no.
You know, when you're a six-year-old. Love to have a little throat cutting. It's just, part of the...
Well, I was thinking of Charlie and the Chocolate Factory specifically. But then I got to thinking about just other properties in general. Look, I was a weird kid. I listened to Sweeney Todd as a kid.
Of course you did.
Yeah.
But when he does his spin on something that already exists, famously, the Mars Attacks cards were not as famous a story, arguably, as Alice in Wonderland or Charlie and the Chocolate Factory or Sleepy Hollow, which is his sort of, you know, steampunk take on, or not steampunk, his sort of...
It says steampunkish, I think.
A little steampunkish.
Yeah.
His take on that story.
Mm-hmm. What did you guys think of
alt colonial?
Yeah,
nice.
What did you guys think of his or even his Planet of the Apes? Do you think there are any standouts among his?
I would say Sleepy Hollow is the standout
for me too. I would agree.
All of these properties,
of those.
But I also feel like Sleepy Hollow was one of those stories where yes, it was already a property, but nobody's really walking around like, oh, we really, really are so familiar with Sleepy Hollow, as opposed to I think a lot of those other properties. I mean, Willy Wonka will only ever be Charlie and the Chocolate Factory to me. Like, I can't. I mean, Charlie Chocolate Factory will only ever. I cannot. I cannot.
No, you
I cannot watch that without seeing Gene Wilder.
That was,
like,
it was a misfire.
I can't dissociate what I already have in that image of that story. Mm-hmm. So like with Sleepy Hollow, nobody's really got that going on.
Like, I don't think we should talk about the films that should not be named. I don't think we should talk about Charlie and the Chocolate Factory.
Voldemort?
Yeah.
I know we have to, because this is what the podcast is about, but sure. I don't think we should talk about Planet of the Apes.
I want to tell one Planet of the Apes story.
Oh, go ahead.
Okay, go.
The movie is a rough watch. I look, anytime, whether I like it or not, I'm glad everybody got work. That's the
always.
Baseline. Mm-hmm. My Welcome to Hollywood moment happened because of Planet of the Apes. I was doing extra work on the first Spider-Man movie, the first Tobey Maguire.
Nice.
I was an extra in the wrestling scenes.
Amazing.
And I went out of the stage to use the bathrooms for the extras. You know, there's a separate building to use the restroom. And so I walked to it. Next door, they were filming Planet of the Apes. So every once in a while, the giant bay doors were open and I saw it was the actual planet set, all the foliage and stuff. And I go walk up to a urinal. And then on either side of me, two of the apes walk up to the urinal in their full costume, talking to each other in the deepest voices imaginable. I don't know if Michael Clark Duncan was one of them. I can't imagine he was. He should have had a trailer. But they both had Michael Clark Duncan-esque voices. And I think one of them was just
doing that to trick you. Neither of them actually sounded like that.
Yeah. Yeah. Then they were like,
they came out there. Well, we really pulled one over on that fella, didn't we?
They didn't even have to pee.
I imagined when I came to LA that it would be like, I'll go to the back lot and you'll see the person in the gladiator outfit and then the pirate over here and then the medieval film was being done.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden I met a urinal with two of the apes from Planet of the Apes.
That's
and
amazing.
I was like, I've arrived.
You could have just retired right then.
But that might have been the best part of the movie. So
that's Well, it made the director's cut.
Let me ask you this, Hal.
Yeah.
That moment that you were looking for, that when you're Welcome to Hollywood moment, is there a particular reference in pop culture that has an excellent example of that we may not have talked a ton about on today, but definitely popped into my head the second you said that?
Oh,
Pee-wee's Big Adventure.
Yes.
Walking around Hollywood. I mean, running through the end. Since you mentioned it, I have to point out, we haven't talked a ton about it. I know we've jumped around to some other things, but Pee-wee's Big Adventure to me is a fairly perfect movie, if not a textbook movie, in that Paul Reubens has said, I loved this quote. He was like, I read a book on screenwriting to write that movie. It is 90 pages. It's 90 minutes. On page 30, he loses the bike. On page 60, he finds the bike. I did everything exactly the way the book told me to do it. And I just thought that was really fun.
It's very fulfilling. Like, it's a very fun ride. And I think what I like the most about that as a movie is that it's just unadulterated play. Like, it's just, it's like you said, it's the textbook, how to make a movie and how scripts work and how you follow characters and those beats of like, oh, now all is lost, but now it's not actually, like, you get all of that, which means you get to just sit back and relax because you're not worried and you're not thinking about what does this mean or where is this going or are they following the rules or like any of the things that sometimes come up when you're watching a movie and it gets too convoluted or too aware of what it's doing or anything like that. It's just, we're just making a fun movie and that's all we're doing. And I think there's something really to respect about that because you as the audience just get to sit back and go on the ride and nothing is being asked of you. But with a Tim Burton movie, you sometimes want a little bit to be asked of you so that you're complicit in the adventure of going to a darker place, I think.
Yeah.
And in the end, and I always forget about it because it's less a Tim Burton movie and more a Pee-wee movie. Like it's, it's a Pee-wee movie and not a Tim Burton movie when I think about it.
Right. There's so many elements. If you want to trace back his family tree of filmmaking, you get his design element also.
Sure.
Because he was a huge fan of Oingo Boingo, he asked Danny Elfman to score the movie for him, which kicked off. Danny Elfman scored all but three of his movies. Wow. And I think that helped. I don't know how much scoring Danny Elfman was doing at that point, like 1984, 85. Feels like he was still I know Oingo Boingo was still going because they were in Back to School the same year.
Right.
So sort of kicked off Danny Elfman's big career as a film composer, and he's one of the greatest of all time.
Yeah.
But it is a Pee-wee Herman movie. It is also a perfect movie, and it also has an element that I think might be worth considering when you're trying to pick the best movie, which is its continued impact. Ed Wood, while it's a great movie, and I'm not trying to eliminate it right now, mm-hmm. there's not a lot that endures unless you've seen the movie. Like, it mm-hmm. hasn't penetrated. But if you look on Twitter once a year, the night that Large Marge went missing starts yeah. to trend on Twitter, and people talk about it.
Yeah.
And the basement of the Alamo. I mean, that's
the basement of the Alamo.
In the lexicon. Like, it's
well, that
everybody
came up like
it.
Politically.
Oh, did it really?
Yeah,
really?
It came up politically in the last, like, when the election was going on. That was like coming up. Somebody was talking about doing
was
like
a QAnon. There really was a basement.
No,
to the
but they
Alamo.
Were going
to
do like a press conference in the basement. Like, that was like it became a thing after the Four Seasons landscape. Oh, like, they were like, it came up and it was actually announced that they were looking into the basement of the Alamo. And I was like, God. Please tell me this is a joke, but honestly, I don't know what I'm supposed to believe anymore. So
yeah.
It's fine.
Yeah, who knows anymore? Oh, but you're right. It endures. Pee Wee's Big Adventure endures.
That's true.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's talk about some of the other, because we've talked about some of the huge ones. Let's talk about some of the others that might have special places in our hearts.
Oh, you just want to talk about Dark Shadows.
No, Dark Shadows. Oh, Dark Shadows.
That's one
where his version of time and place didn't quite work. Right. Where he's like, get a specific. Okay. The when and the where is always very important and very specific. Oh, it's the 60s. All right. Put a macrame thing on the wall. And you're like, okay. This is just did not work terribly well. No, Corpse Bride is a great one. Big Fish. Like, these are beloved, beloved movies. I just wanted to make sure that.
And did he direct Corpse Bride? He didn't direct Night Eater, but he did direct Corpse Bride. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, let's talk about this. Since he didn't direct it, we never said movie specifically directed by Tim Burton.
You're right.
Come
you just
on.
Said Tim Burton.
Do we consider The Nightmare Before Christmas a Tim Burton movie?
Only if you'll consider Cabin Boy to be a Tim Burton movie, because he also produced that and was going to direct it.
Wow. Well done, Hal.
Well done. Which I'm not going to lie. I do not hate Cabin Boy. It looks like it was shot on a stage in the 1950s, and it's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks like he just stumbled onto the set of HMS Pinafore and was like, go grab a camera, let's make a movie. But this middle school needs its Pinafore set. Who cares?
Yeah, that's a tough one, because everybody, you could probably ask, 10 people on the street and 9 of them would say he directed it.
Well, because you hear because the way they announce
and the aesthetic
and promote,
is,
but they also put his name on things. And
sure. Tim Burton's Nightmare Before Christmas.
Yeah. Right. So like people don't always pay attention, especially if you're not in the industry. People aren't really paying attention to what all the credits actually mean. So. Yeah. Even if sometimes a writer writes something that's usually a director, sometimes they don't always, the audience doesn't always know. So I would say a lot of people do believe it to be a Tim Burton film.
You almost have to consider it.
I think so, because if it's given the possessive, if it's given the, like you said, Tim Burton's Nightmare Before Christmas, then the possessive that is implied by that is the same possessive that we use on this show to say whether something
speaking of
is
possessive,
someone's
movie. Hal is becoming possessed by the spirit of Henry Selick, who's not dead, by the way, but I can see you're becoming possessed.
But as a producer, if you're a good producer, you would have a say into decision-making processes for things like aesthetics and story and character, like you script, stuff like that. So maybe he does deserve more credit as far as making that movie into what it is.
Yeah. I mean, it was his concept. He pitched it as a television special when he was still working at Disney, and they did not want to do it. So it lived on as this film. He could have directed it, considering it was his, but he was coming off of, he had Batman Returns that he was working on, and also Ed Wood. So he chose specifically, he wanted to make Ed Wood more than he wanted to make A Nightmare Before Christmas as the director. There is work as a director that you need to do that he was not able to do because he was working on something else. So it's of course his, the look of it alone. If you took everything else out of it, if you turn the sound off, you would say, this is a Tim Burton movie, right?
Yeah.
This looks like Tim Burton.
Yeah.
But it's
Danny Elfman did the music and even sings throughout.
Yeah.
Well, Empire Strikes Back is a George Lucas movie. Yeah. But if Irvin Kershner doesn't direct it, it's completely different.
You're absolutely right.
But you still associate Empire Strikes Back with George Lucas.
Of course. But this isn't the best film associated with Tim Burton. I think we're talking about the stuff he directs.
Yeah. Okay.
Right.
That's my feeling.
That's fair. I think that it might be moot because I still think Beetlejuice wins. But I think I'd be hard pressed to say that The Nightmare Before Christmas is not a Tim Burton movie.
What are our finalists?
Even though he didn't technically direct
right now. Beetlejuice, Ed Wood.
Beetlejuice, right? Ed Wood, and we put Edward Scissorhands in there only Edward so that you could eliminate it, I think you said.
Well, I don't know. I was just asking.
We put it on there so we could eliminate it.
Yeah. So we'll wait
just
to do that.
Just to make his life a little sadder.
Yeah.
Do we want either of his big movies, Big Fish or Big Eyes?
Or Big Eyes.
Or Big Adventure.
Can we talk about Big Eyes?
So many bigs.
I loved Big Eyes. I had no idea it was a Tim Burton movie. I watched it. I loved it. I thought Christoph Waltz was great. I thought Amy Adams was brilliant.
Yeah.
I didn't know the story. I had seen those paintings before.
Yeah.
So like it was one of those sort of cool, crazy things that I had never thought about.
Yeah.
But it does not seem at all like a Tim Burton movie.
Right.
That and said, I love it.
Yeah. And I think that it is an interesting film, but it also doesn't really feel like it's his movie. So
it doesn't check all the boxes.
Yeah.
It kind of feels like the story of it is really interesting, and Amy Adams is great, and Christoph Waltz is great. It feels like at a certain point it kind of peters out. Like, is there more? Is this going to be more about the courtroom drama? Nope, this feels pretty short. This courtroom part that's kind of like the crux.
Yeah, we thought the eyes were really interesting. Let's get into that again.
Does the judge have big eyes? Does the judge also know? Okay. So Pee Wee's Big Adventure is not a finalist.
Well, I mean, I think it's a great film, but I don't know that I think it's one of the
Okay.
Yeah.
And Big Fish, which it seems like we have division amongst the two of you.
Some people love that movie and think it is a masterpiece and brilliant. I'm just not one of those people. You know, it doesn't mean that it's not. It just means that I don't think it is. You know, I mean, that's all that means.
And although I liked it more than him, I don't think that it's nearly as good as Beetlejuice. So it wouldn't pop Beetlejuice off my list for me at all.
Right.
Yeah, Mark, there are a couple of movies that are all four of us. They are definitely on the top of the pile for all four of us. So how I feel is that we should quickly tell the people of the world about what's going on with the Max Fun Drive and then come back and we will talk about our finalists. We will be right back right after this.
The theme of this year's Max Fun Drive is community. And that means that we're creating something together. We put out the show, you listen to it, and we wanted to learn a little bit more about what our show means to you. So we asked and you answered. And we got this submission from Nikki. Here are just a few of the really kind things that she had to say about We Got This. We Got This is just one of my fave podcasts from Max Fun.
Thank you, Nikki.
Thank you, Nikki. Mark and Hal are two most genially funny and kind guys. Thank you, Nikki.
Oh, thank you, Nikki.
We Got This gives you so much fun on topics you didn't even think on debating.
I love. Thank you, Nikki.
Thank you.
I love that to me, the idea that these are topics that you would never think of debating is kind of the point of this show. So I'm glad that we've given that to Nikki. And she says they always make me smile. And this I will agree with 100%. The guests they have on are always epic. Yes. So we try to get great guests and we try to get them to talk about things that they have either secret passion for or they think they have no passion for. And then suddenly they're standing on a chair yelling at you about the crunchiness of Cheerios. So thank you for your kind words, Nikki. And she says also it takes a special person to make a podcast that can stop dark thoughts from overtaking. And this has been a rough year for everybody. And I know we've all had a lot of dark thoughts throughout this time. And thank you so much. It means so much to us, A, that you would be free in sharing that, and B, that the community that this show has created, the people of the world, is something that brings a little bit of light.
That's right. If you feel the way that Nikki feels about the guests we have and about the show that we do, know that that is happening and it continues to happen because of you and your support, especially during times like Max Fun Drive. Because of you. Because all of you who listen and all of you and people who have reached out and said how nice it is to have the show, especially during what's been a very difficult year, sort of keep you company. We're still there with you. It means a lot to us. And it's not easy to continue to make shows during a time like this. But one of the things that keeps us going is knowing that we get to do the show the way that we want directly because of your support, because of the support of Max Fun members. And now during Max Fun Drive, is a chance for you to either become a member for the first time, to become a member yet again, or to boost your existing membership. And most folks start off with $5 per month. And if that's where you're comfortable, that's great. If you're comfortable with more, that's great. Just know that when you become a member, when you boost your membership, you're also supporting all the people who aren't able to become members right now.
Hey, Hal, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
If I join at $10 a month, mm-hmm. will I be able to select from this year's crop of Maximum Fun pins?
Yes.
Okay. Is one of the pins that is included in that mm-hmm. a pin that has a picture of the best pretzel shape on it?
What it is, Mark, that I think you're trying to get at is a reference to our best pretzel shape episode where your refusal to budge from your choice.
That pretzel shape is the best pretzel shape?
A dark path.
Ugh.
So you can get a pin from the show from one of the most often referenced episodes, which is worth a listen if you haven't heard it yet. It is a picture of the customary pretzel shape, and surrounding it are the words, "This is not the best pretzel shape."
Oh, customary. I can't believe you just threw down with, "It's the customary pretzel shape." Anyway, get that pin, yes. People of the world.
You also
get that pin, listener. That's you're going right. to love it. It's a really fun pin.
You will also get what everybody at the $5 level gets, which is access to all of the bonus content. We've done this. This is our sixth Maximum Fun Drive that we've done. So you get six different bonus episodes of ours, plus from all the other great shows on the Max Fun Network. This year we did, what is the worst chore? Is it doing the dishes or doing the laundry? And we'll decide. You don't have to argue with people anymore about it. We got you.
There is a correct answer. We know what it is because we've already taken the dive. You don't yet, but you will when you get that bonus content at $5 a month. At $10 a month, you can get that amazing pin with the best pretzel shape that says this is not the best pretzel shape. And there are gifts at other levels too. But if you're not too worried about getting gifts, but you just want to give a little more, you can also just boost your membership to any amount between levels that you would like. The real gift for us is knowing that you are supporting We Got This with Mark and Hal and all the shows at the Max Fun Network.
Yes, we know and are grateful for all the people who are able to become members right now and do, but also however you are able to support our show and however you choose to support it, this is the time of year where not only you support us, but we continue to thank you for your support because it means the world to both me and Mark. How many people listen to the show each week? Each episode, each month, and how many of you have decided to turn that membership in our community to membership in the Maximum Fun community as a whole, an actual deeper level of support for the show. So if you're ready to join right now, if you're ready to boost or you're ready to upgrade,
you JBU,
join
booster upgrade.
JBU, you know where to do it, which is at MaximumFun.org/join. And the important part of that,
I think the forward was implied. You could just say slash join.
I always say forward slash. There's a backslash out there, Mark. And if we're not responsible about it.
What are we, coders?
Maybe. You don't know what I do when I'm not on a microphone with you.
Go to MaximumFun.org/join right now. And then come back, hit play, and listen to the rest of the episode.
But be sure when you're signing up, when you are joining or boosting or upgrading, when you are JBUing, to check the box.
JBU!
When they ask you what shows you listen to, all the shows that you check off are the ones that will benefit from a portion of that recurring monthly contribution. So we certainly hope if you're listening to this that we will be one of those shows. We think we've earned it and we appreciate the support from everyone who is willing to give it.
And now, let's get back to the exciting conclusion of We Got This with Mark and Hal. Okay, our finalists are Beetlejuice, Ed Wood, and Edward Scissorhands.
That's a solid trio.
Oh, I feel bad for Big Fish, but I also don't think it's a finalist. I really like it a lot.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think part of why I'm holding on to it is I know how much Jennifer loves it.
Oh, yeah.
And that's great. It says a lot that he can make things that are, I'll tell you, just reading about him for the past week, if I ever see the word quirky again in print, I'm going to hurl all written words into the sea.
The best Tim Burton just insight that I've seen lately is if you guys have seen, I think it was Waking Sleeping Beauty, the documentary on Disney Plus. There's a documentary about
the early 80s animators at Disney. Mm. I think it's Waking Sleeping Beauty is the name of this movie. And it's a lot of the footage is just people walking around with camcorders around the Disney animation offices. And periodically they walk past the desk of this like 20-year-old black clad goth kid who's very quiet and just periodically looks up deadpan and stares into the camera. And you're like, oh my God, it's baby Tim Burton in the early 80s as a Disney animator. Completely miss. It really is like looking at Edward Scissorhands sitting there at the Disney animators building in Glendale.
Amazing.
Yeah. Yeah.
I love it.
So good. It's, I was just saying, it's nice to think that he can make those quirkier films. I said it again.
You said it.
But also,
he's so quirky. That's the thing.
But also make something with heart that kind of reaches beyond.
Yeah.
I think there is like a Tim Burton fandom. Mm-hmm. And then sometimes you have a group of people who just like what you do and they want you to do that forever. Like, I want everything to be Edward Scissorhands. So make Alice in Wonderland that style. Make, you know, but his ability to sort of reach beyond that and capture the imaginations and hearts of people who might not like what is considered to be core Tim Burton is pretty spectacular.
Yeah.
It's like he can show you really, really well what a tombstone looks like, that you forget that he can show you what a rose looks like.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, he's very good at doing that too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, sure. That's what Big Fish feels like.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know?
Okay.
But it's not
like with the giant and the nuts. No. I don't think we need finalists, guys. I'm gonna say it right here. I'm Team Beetlejuice.
I'm with you. I'm Team Beetlejuice.
Yeah.
You joined our team?
I did.
Oh, how is this? What about you, Hal?
Are you going to make this unanimous?
You're gonna make this difficult, aren't you?
People of the world, let me count the windows. Beetlejuice. Is he here?
Oh, no!
Oh, no!
It's showtime!
Yeah,
he waited. Alex Brightman is here singing right now. Go see the Broadway musical when it reopens. If it reopens, I hope it does. It's amazing.
Think about this, everybody. 36 years ago, he makes his first film, establishes his visual style, and brings on his composer, his John Williams, then waits 3 years to make a movie. Now, after having a hit, and if you wait 3 years, that could be the end. You don't know if your next movie, if anybody's going to remember you, if it's going to be any good. What does this guy do? He creates a movie that has spawned an animated series, which was really enjoyable, a hit Broadway musical. Now he's working on the sequel. It turned Michael Keaton into an even bigger star and gets in Batman and keeps his career going. Like, just everything about that movie. It's a perfect film.
Yeah.
It's a perfect film. If you love Catherine O'Hara, it's a perfect film. If you love Winona Ryder.
And introduce a whole generation to Harry Belafonte. Really,
yes. You know? Harry Belafonte.
Our 4-year-old son knows the name Harry Belafonte because of Beetlejuice.
Yeah.
Amazing.
There's no higher praise than that.
There he goes.
No higher praise. The best Tim Burton movie is the second Tim Burton movie ever made. It's Beetlejuice, asked and answered. At the beginning, by the way, like maybe an hour before we were scheduled to hop on and talk to each other, Mark and I were texting, and we both texted what we thought the answer was, and we both said Beetlejuice coming into it. So when you said at the beginning, I was like, oh, we got to stretch this to an hour. We can't. No, you did nothing wrong, but
yeah.
I think it's worth taking a walk through films of Tim Burton.
Yeah. I mean, there's so much there that's interesting and creative and wildly aesthetic and memorable. And to be able to create these images that stick with audiences, whether or not you're somebody who watches something on repeat or not, is a very powerful skill set that not every filmmaker can say they can do. Like, a filmmaker might make a great movie that you were very touched by when you're watching it, but that's an emotional touching. You know, like, there's different things that different filmmakers bring to the table. And I think Tim Burton would be proud that his imagery is one of the things that sticks with people, that people can see it, or it's a visceral feeling when you connect to both the dark and the play that happens in Beetlejuice. Like when they're sitting around the table and the shrimp hands come, like it's just such a, you react because you're so overjoyed that they went there, that he did that, that he took the chance, and that he was so wackadoo off the park that he didn't care whether you were on board, that he was going to make sure you were on board because he was going to do it anyway. And I think there's something really fun about that if you are honest about going on the audience ride.
Yeah. And it's a complete story. Just every note is perfect. And it's a great, like, if you've never seen anything that Tim Burton's made before, which is hard to believe. I feel like everybody's seen at least one Tim Burton. Yeah. It's a great place to start.
And a story I hadn't already seen many times. Like the story of Beetlejuice is like, I can't think of another, you know, there are only five stories, whatever, but I feel like I had one of these isn't one of those five, you know, Beetlejuice isn't one of those five stories.
Yeah. 100%.
Haunt the new owners of your house isn't one of the five original.
In a surprising turn of events. Right.
Yeah. Also, like, how do you be a ghost?
Like, yeah, like really on page 30, is that when the car goes off the bridge? I don't know exactly what the.
Yeah. You introduce your main characters and kill them immediately.
Yeah.
Yeah. But that's the begin. That's, you know, that's your, you know, that's the, yeah.
Just incredible.
That's your page 10.
Well, that's it, Hal.
Asked and answered.
Asked and answered. Thank you. Oh, man. It's so good to see you both.
Likewise. To see you guys too.
This, really?
Selfishly.
Such a delight.
Yeah.
I know. This makes me very happy. What do you want people to tell them what's going on? You would check out your book. What's happening?
Other than the fact that I'm going to go put ketchup on a hot dog, there it is.
How dare you?
Yes, we have a book on voice acting called Voice Over Voice Actor, the extended edition. It's available on Amazon. And there was a sci-fi show that I did a couple of years ago. It was for a streaming platform that Legendary had that went defunct very soon after. And so not a lot of people got to see the show. It was live sci-fi. It was a new episode every week. It was performed live. It was live action. All the visual effects, all the sound effects, the score was performed live on the stage. It was all one take, multiple cameras.
But it looks like Battlestar Galactica.
Whoa.
It looks like an episode of,
you know, a sci-fi show that you'd watch, like a produced.
And the audience got to vote on things. So live, the actors would find out what the audience vote was and they would have to change dialogue to incorporate. It was just, it was insanity.
It was space madness.
It's like Edwin Drood Voyager.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And not a lot of people got to see it just because of the platform.
Mm-hmm.
But the rights reverted back to us. And Dust picked it up, and you're going to get to see the whole first season on Dust at the end of the summer. Now, it won't
be
live.
Fantastic.
It won't be live, obviously, but because we're rolling on it, we were able to cut it together and master it and everything. And I'm just really excited for people to, you know, actually be able to watch it.
It's a really good show.
It's called Orbital Redux. Sorry, I never mentioned the name.
I know. I was going to say, what's it called
again?
That sounds amazing.
Tim Burton's Orbital Redux.
Ooh. He just produced it. He didn't direct it, but he put it as a Tim Burton's.
The only Tim Burton element is that I added his name into this pitch. It'll be on Dust at the end of the summer. I'm not exactly sure what the date is, but it's coming soon and I'm really excited.
This is very, very exciting. Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah.
On the re-release of your live show. Very cool. And thank you again for coming on and
thanks
doing
for asking
this with
us,
this.
You guys. It's really
wait, do you want to say now, let's set up the sequel. What was the topic that you thought we would pick that we did not, that we will reserve for you?
It was biscuits. It was biscuits. It's what do you put on biscuits? Was it butter, jelly,
or honey?
Okay.
Believe it or not, that was on the list.
Reserved for you.
Or I made that up. And I just wanted to talk
about it. To be fair, during quarantine, Yuri's gotten very good at baking biscuits. We've eaten a lot of biscuits because it's one of the things that he's really good at.
I've
like Southern style biscuits?
Oh, yeah.
Southern
like buttermilk biscuits.
Buttermilk flaky.
And a cast iron?
Biscuits.
You get flaky biscuits?
Yeah. I'm not in a cast iron. Oh, that's how I should level it up. We should see if I can
level it up to the cast iron.
I have a cast iron that's been sitting. I need to
can't do the flaky.
It's about freezing the butter and grating it.
There's so many. It's science. Yeah. And it took me many tries before I got it.
And you can only stir it like three times.
Let's save it for the show.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, we're talking about this.
This is very exciting. We got to talk about this.
Reserved. We're putting a pin in it until we next speak to the listeners. We'll talk. I mean, obviously, we'll all see each other soon. I hope. Please.
Please.
Amen. Well, this topic is closed, but there are many more topics to discuss, like biscuits. So please reach out to us on Twitter at We Got This Tweets, or
you can email us at wegotthispodcast@gmail.com, or go to the Facebook group, Celebrate the Quirkiness of Tim Burton at facebook.com/group/ We Got This Podcast. Drives you crazy, doesn't it? To hear it over and over again.
It really does. Yeah. It really does.
Thank you to producer Ken Plume, researcher Kate McManus, graphic designer Uri Kelman, and QA engineer Jen Alba.
And thanks, of course, to our musicians, Jonathan Dinerstein and Mike Furman, for our score and theme song, respectively. And thanks to you, the people of the world, for giving us a chance to, Deo. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And an extra thank you. If you have gone the extra mile to become a Max Fun member, you are making this show possible. We're able to bring you our show independent of any outside influence because our audience, people like you, have chosen to support it, and we can't thank you enough.
This episode may almost be over, but we have almost a week of Max Fun Drive yet to go. So there's still time to support us and the other shows that you listen to and enjoy. So if you are not yet a member, go over to MaximumFun.org/join. It's real easy, and it's always appreciated. Thanks.
For Hal Loveland, I'm Mark Gagliardi.
For Mark Gagliardi, I'm Hal Loveland. And don't worry, everybody.
We got this.
We got this.
MaximumFun.org.
Comedy and culture.
Artist owned.
Audience supported.